Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, Agnes Varda again. A warm welcome to you. Woo! Können wir das Mikro anmachen da vorne? Ist es an? Ja, improvising. Also,
es ist immer angenehm, so begrüßt zu werden.
So, then, shall I say some words?
Yeah?
Yes. Good evening and welcome again. Agnes Varda, you are really and truly a fascinating personality for all of us. You are a part of the Nouvelle Vague. You are an important documentary filmmaker and a highly regarded trendsetter in video art and photography. And in 2015, this to the discussion we always do have, not at last with the Oscar celebration, you were the first female director to receive the honorary Golden Palm in Cannes for your lifetime achievements, the first woman ever. And recently you were awarded the Max Beckmann Prize of the City of Frankfurt. So congratulations from all of us. Well, it is a very special gift to our audience and to us to have been able to watch almost all of your films during a period of 10 months in our lecture and films series. And therefore, I now and here and today would like to thank our collaborating partners, the Institute for Theater, Film and the Media at Frankfurt, and welcome Professor Vincent Sedior, who is sitting there, right? And the Cluster of Excellence, the Formation of Normative Orders at Frankfurt University. Welcome to Klaus Günther, Linde Storm and Susanne Bernhardt, the Hessen Film and Media Agency, the Institute L'Institut Franco-Allemand de Sciences Historiques et Sociales. Welcome Dominique Petre. And of course, Ciné Tamaris, the production company of Agnes Varda. I will make my speech very short. There were some problems in crossing the river to arrive at Rive Gauche. And next, we will see today or tonight Le Bonheur from 1965, a film that you, Agnes, compared in an interview with A Beautiful Rotten Fruit. And we are excited to watch the newly digitally restored version of Le Bonheur in all its beauty in the original version with English subtitles. And now we would be glad if you could say some words to us, my dear. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your welcoming words. I'm glad to be back here. I feel like I have an abundant, you know, I come like a permanent guest. And it is true that I'm always surprised that years after a film is shown, it's a pleasure because it's not, you know, you make a new film, ça va pas?
Juste.
You make a new film, it goes out in theaters and somewhere in festivals, etc. But when it's an old film, I feel touched. Maybe you came by curiosity, or you know the film, or you heard of it, but this is more than what, 50 years that I made that film. So it's not the same person who's here, the one who made the film, which is quite normal. And you said a rotten fruit. It's not exactly my word. My word is, it's a beautiful fruit, but inside there is a worm. It's slightly different, but it still looks beautiful. It doesn't look rotten. Happiness has to be a beautiful fruit. And when I made the film, I wrote it very fast on this very simple idea, is that we are all unique, perfectly unique, but replaceable. Replaceable, is that the word?
Mm-hmm.
Remplaceable.
Oui, replaceable.
And as society needs the unity, the family is a stone of the society. A man, a woman, one kid, two, three kids. It's a cell that should exist all the time. And it seems very cold to say that, but I love to see happy families. And I remember loving the picnics and loving to see in gardens or parks families picnicking together and kids, you know, sleeping under a tree, playing, swimming, all this. And I thought that there is a sort of cliché look, image of the family. And it is, comment dire, repeated by the media, by the women media, the family media, a nice family, kids, everybody, she's blonde, she looks good, he's tall, and he works, he's honest, and all that, which I believe is wonderful. And I remember families of workers that I really admire because they were simply working, being happy, enjoying the Saturday and the Sunday. And I felt I should try to tell with my images and my words. Obviously, I was impressed by the impressionist painters who have been painting the L'Île de France, the country around Paris, with beautiful and sweet colors. And I made a film very colorful. I love the sun in the clear woods. I love the little ponds with water. People go fishing, and I thought I could tell. And then when I wrote the film, I remember that there was a series on TV called Thierry Lafronde. It was, I don't know if it came here, it was a nice guy in the Middle Age, and he kind of Zorro of the Middle Age. He was on his horse, you know, and singing, and he had a medal like this, and he's saving the poor, saving the mistreated people. And it was an actor, Jean-Claude Roux, beautiful man. And on a magazine, I had seen a photo of him, his wife, and kids. I thought, I should ask him to act, and then second question, would you like to come with your family? And it happened that they accepted. The wife, beautiful woman, said, I don't know if I should do that. I hope it will bring me bad luck or something about, you know, being betrayed. Anyway, they came, all of them, and we spent beautiful 2 months in these woods, and the kids were behaving naturally with their children, with their parents, and the parents with their children. So I had a good time when we did that. But you'll see the film builds in a way that, well, there is a worm in the fruit. And I understand we have a conversation after the film. Yeah, so I spoke too much then.
No, but...
So I hope you will enjoy the sweet, what is it, the sweet colors of happiness.
Okay.
Vous ne faites pas de présentation, vous. On se revoit tout à l'heure.
Non.
Should we wait here or we come back? Sure.
Viel Spaß mit dem Film und wir kommen dann gleich wieder zurück.
And Vincent Hediger, who is talking to her. Think. Now, welcome again. Now you are in here on stage. Another applause for Agnes Varda. Welcome in Frankfurt.
Voilà. We just caught the last scene, and the last few images, and I mean, what you can tell is that the work you put into restoring the films was well worth it. This is a very painterly film, and the colors were just beautiful.
But the restoration meaning is that it should look like it looked when we made it.
Right.
So in a way, it's a lot of job, a lot of work, and a lot of money, but forget about that. You see the film the way it was done more than 50 years ago.
I'm sure there's a lot of questions from the audience. Sie können die Fragen in der Sprache Ihrer Wahl stellen und ich werde es dann zu übersetzen versuchen. Donc, je vais traduire.
Und ich komme zu Ihnen, wenn Sie eine Frage haben. Geben Sie mir nur ein Zeichen, da ist schon die erste. Können Sie es einmal weitergeben?
Ja, tout de suite une question.
Hello.
Bonjour.
How do you feel about monogamous relationships?
How do you feel about monogamous relationships?
Donc,
qu'est-ce que vous pensez de la monogamie?
Quelle drôle de question! Je pense que chaque film contient son propre sujet, sa propre proposition, mais on ne peut pas, d'un film, penser que ça décrit toutes les situations possibles ou toutes les pensées possibles. C'est un film qui est limité à sa situation. Mm. Mais peut-être je devrais parler.
Right. Also, es ist jeder Film enthält eine eigene Situation und erzählt die Geschichte, die erzählt. Das ist keine Theorie, keine allgemeine Beschreibung der Welt. In diesem Film geht es die Situation, die hier beschrieben wird.
I think the problem of living in a couple is a big problem because it's a desire, it's a utopia. It's a problem, it's real life. There are so many ways that you can approach yes. The question that it's really everybody has to do his own way to think about what we desire. Mm-hmm. Je peux parler anglais, là, ça va?
Oui, ça va très bien.
Ah.
Tout le monde vous comprend. La prochaine question.
Also, gespenstisch. Über die Austauschbarkeit von Menschen. Der Film ist ja aus seiner Perspektive, wird er uns erzählt, also finde ich, dass er eben die Hauptperson ist und man kann ihn sogar immer wieder verstehen, wenn es so geht. Mhm. Was ich nicht verstanden habe, ob das im Französischen dann erzählt wurde, als sie, die Ehefrau, tot ist. Was sagen die Leute? Ist es ein Unfall? Ist es ein Selbstmord? Wird in dem Film irgendwas dazu noch gesagt? Weil für mich als Zuschauerin ist es eine Reaktion als Überforderung, sozusagen, in die junge Frau gestellt war. Und natürlich gehe ich davon aus, sie ist ins Wasser gegangen. Und zwar wirklich, wie der Ausdruck im Deutschen ist, ins Wasser gehen.
Hm. Très long, tu retiens tout ça?
Oui, j'essaie, je vais faire un effort.
Voilà.
Donc, elle a ouvert en disant qu'il y a un côté fantomatique, il y a un secret. C'est un film qu'elle a vu comme être raconté du point de vue de l'acteur, de la figure principale, donc du protagoniste mâle. Mais il y a une question qui n'est pas résolue pour elle, qu'elle n'a pas bien compris, c'est est-ce que elle se suicide, est-ce que c'est un accident, qu'est-ce que pensent les gens de cet événement. La lecture qui s'impose est qu'elle est, comme on dit en allemand, ins Wasser gegangen, aller dans l'eau, donc elle s'est suicidée en se noyant. Et la question est, est-ce que le film, dans la version française, explique ce qui s'est passé?
The question you raise is the question has been always around. And it's a question for myself. Did she kill herself or it happened that she slid? It's the question, do we die sometime by all circumstances bringing us to slide? Or did she want to do something? But as you see in the film, for one second, you see that she tried to grab something. So it's a way of saying that maybe she fall in the water and try to save herself. I put that shot to raise the question. I don't know. I don't know because when I write a film, I don't want to be the demiurge who knows everything. I think the characters have their own life, and in a way, I should not decide what happened. But everybody in the audience believes most of the time that she committed suicide. I don't know.
Yes, next question.
Vous avez pris l'attitude de l'homme. Comment est-ce que vous, en tant que réalisatrice, vous prenez la position de l'homme? Parce que lui, il est complètement... Il n'est pas triste. Il est triste d'une part, mais d'autre part, il peut continuer à vivre. Est-ce que ça n'a pas été difficile? Parce que c'était dans une période où vous l'avez tourné en 65, où il y a eu, par exemple, aussi les discussions de l'émancipation de la femme, etc.
Il traduit la question.
Oui. Traduit-la en allemand, peut-être.
Oui, c'est ça. Non, en français. Die Frage lautet, oder die geht aus von der Feststellung, dass eben der Film die Position des Mannes in gewisser Weise einnimmt und vertritt, jedenfalls sehr viel Verständnis aufbringt für den Mann als glücklich zeigt. Und die Frage lautet eigentlich, wie kann Agnès Varda als Frau, als Regisseurin diese Position einnehmen und wie ist das zu verstehen vor dem gesellschaftspolitischen Hintergrund der Entstehungszeit der 60er Jahre, in dem ja gerade die Emanzipation der Frau zu einem zentralen Thema wird. Voilà.
At the time I had many thoughts about that man. And everybody says he's a selfish, just selfish. I said, well, not so much. He's just working, bringing his money home. He takes care of his wife. He does things for his children. He builds toys for them. And he loves just to be with his wife and kids and go to the nature and the country and have picnics. So I figured him as a man, very natural, loving wife, children, and nature, and loving trees, and loving being outside. And nothing could happen to him, but just one thing which exists and so strong is what is called desire. What do we do with desire? Should we listen to it? Is that it exists every time, every minute? Every minute we can desire somebody else than the usual companion. And so I figured the man could be like innocent related to decision. He's before the moral. He's just, I would say, just so natural. And it's incredible that when he meets another girl, you should notice that she's almost the same than his wife. You know, it's not a story in which he's with a blonde and meets a very, a brune, very brunette, very coquette. he meets the same wife in a way, the same woman type that he likes, sweet and blonde. And it, so far, as the way I wrote it, he doesn't resist to the desire, but he's in a way or stupid or very naive, but he thinks that if his wife asked him to stop, he would stop, but if she doesn't ask him to stop, why not? And the why not about not resisting to desire, it's a real problem. Young people who go together with somebody, as in a way, it's not natural. Somebody asked a question about monogamy. Is it normal to love one person a long time? Is it person to resist to whatever is around us? So I made him innocent. He's selfish and innocent. I think at the end of the film, he's less innocent. But the way, I think it's very cruel for women, the way the second wife, comment elle s'appelle, Emily, the way she's patient, and when he comes to the post and tell her that his wife died, and she knows it already, and she says very honestly, I'm unhappy, because her desire is to go with him, which is natural. It's just people are so natural, so frank, so open, that it's difficult to listen and to see. And she's waiting for him to recover and she knows that she will be with him, and she will do the job, take the children to school, and do the cooking and do the ironing. A lot of women have been that kind of life. And I know that a lot of feminists were enraged against me. How could you describe women like this? But millions of women have been like this, and not complaining, and not mad at everybody. So I think it was interesting to describe it as it is, and it was in very many situations. And I had the idea that moral, if you're not taught by school, by religion, by family, there is no reason to have a moral. He has to invent it himself. I took a case very easy in a way, because he's not a worker in a factory, because he would meet a guy like this, he would be in a union or something. He's worked with his uncle, so it's not really a boss. She does, comment dit seamstress, she does dresses for the neighborhood. They seem to be in good shape, both working like this. Why should they have, you know, pressure? If the children were older, I couldn't tell the story, because you cannot put a child of 9 or 12 with changing, switching, zapping mother like this. But when they're small, you know, when they're small, they go with who takes care of them. So I made it easy for me, because the children are small, there is no pressure of family, they have no religion, nobody takes them what they should do or not. And see, if people are raised like this in freedom, in a way, why should they have a rule? The question is, what is desire? What do we do with it? That's the way I saw the film. And the way she can be replaced doesn't mean that the first wife was not unique, and this one is unique, and he is unique. But in a society, it has to, comment dit, il faut que ça fonctionne. It has to function.
It has to work.
And if a family has a man, a woman, two kids, go to school, eat at night, close the gas, I mean, life is going on. So it's, I think it's the same time, natural and cruel. But in terms of women, and I was a feminist, and still I am, but it's not because you are a feminist that you cannot point situation in which women are just naturally accepting everything. So it's about that, and about the way society builds an image of happiness, the classical image, you know, a couple of children, they're lovely, they look good. I think the press and the magazine, and mostly the women magazine, were proposing that image, that should be happiness. If we wish that, try to be thin, try to be blonde, and try to have nice children. But it's true that reality is much more cruel than that. That's why I said when I introduced the film that it's the way I try to describe it with the impressionist colors. It's a beautiful fruit, but the worm is in it, and the worm is what happens.
We have another question and another question.
I was amazed to see such a colorful film, and starting with the flowers and the first montage, going on to these nearly monochrome images where the screen went completely red, blue. And I was wondering if you could come and say a few words about your choice of colors.
So about first, you raise a point precise that what were the fade out, fade in, were always black. The image would fade to black and come back. And I thought, why couldn't they fade to red or to blue? When it's the Bastille Day, the color fade to blue, then there is one white frame and then red and opens from red to the image. Little joke, it's a little color jokes, but the lab had never done it. And they were discovering that we could fade to a color. So that was a choice about the technical fade out and fade in. The color, as I said, I wanted to give the sweetness in a way the impressionist painters who have been painting around Paris, like at the places where we shot. And it's a question of choosing the color where they are. But I trick a little, because sometimes I wanted some touch of blue or yellow, and I had a bomb, and I would in the frame in when it was set, I would bomb a flower or something another, and for the time of the shooting was beautiful, and then they die half an hour later. So I was tricking a little with the colors, but most of the time, the real color of the nature were beautiful, because it's a question of light, the time of the light, which shows, you have to choose that the light comes from the side. So you did, okay, we should do that shot at 10 and not at 4 p.m. And another said we should do that scene at that moment. So the work of the director of photography, and I do it myself, is when you look, when you do location scouting, to look at the light, where it comes, and be able to say, okay, we should do that shot, that scene at that hour. We had a back problem because I wanted to do a very difficult traveling shot, which is the scene in which he speaks to his wife. And we had rented a rail like this and another crossing. So it would be a cross and go in direction. Very long installation. And long rehearsal, because in the same shot, they should be there and go and sit, and he tells her, and they lie down and they go up, and then she throws her, comment dit son jupon, under skirt, and we think that we'll make love. Okay. So it's a shot of almost 5 minutes, which now a lot of films are long shot. We had L'Arche de Noé, comment on dit le. The film came to
the Noah's Ark, the Ark of Noah.
Was one shot, and now there is a film that came out. It's one shot.
Yeah.
So, but at the time, it was difficult to do long shot. So we rehearsed and decided to make the shoot at the right time, which was between 4 and 6 afternoon. We do the shot. C'est pas bien? We do the shot, and that box, the lab forgot it in the bath. So the day after we were doing something else, they say, hey, we lost the shot. because we depend on many things. The lab, the man who did the timing of the developing forgot. And his love scene was in the water in the bath for hours. So we had to redo it. And in that case, I was so impressed. The insurance reimbursed the stock. So 300 meters. And so what about the job and the difficulty? And we had to redo the traveling and rehearse and redo it, and it came out fine. But we are always dependent of images in which you think you'll do the happiness and you get the difficulty all the time. Can I tell a totally different story?
Yes, please.
I was shooting a short film on the Riviera. It's called Du Côté de la Côte. And I had decided the only place of happiness are islands, and where there is nobody. So I filmed the island, and then you see a pair of horses being very free. And we decided beautiful. I wanted to do the beginning of the world. So we had found big roots coming out of the tree that you could see in the sand. And I asked the co-producer and his wife to lie down naked in between a pomme de pin. So it was not a, je sais pas comment on dit pomme de pin en anglais, en allemand. But in French, it's pineapple.
Ananas.
So it was supposed to replace the apple. So they were lying beautiful, the apple. And the traveling was very long to organize the roots and then the trees. And then at the end, there was a little bay, sand, beautiful. It looked like paradise. So we do the shot. And when we rehearsed, suddenly, what's happening? People on that beach. It's supposed to be nobody. It's an island. So I send, I'm very brusque, I said, get these people out, run. He runs, he goes to the beach, he comes back very pale. You see, it's the only day where an hospital of handicapés are brought to the beach. And so they have been brought by boat, and then everybody carries them by hand and put them on the sand in the middle of my view. So and it was so symbolic that you try to say something which is pure and full of happiness and the beach, which is the most beautiful landscape. And here your reality is there. So we decided to go speak to them, and we said, look, we have to do that shot, but we will carry you just a little further. And so all the crew, we were seven people, right? We carried the people, because the people I come to bring them were gone, they were coming back. So we carry these poor people, put them a little further on the beach. So our view was saved. But you see, we are always taken by reality, that we have to face reality. And that was an example perfect, because handicapped people on the beach, they were such happiness to be there, you know. In their way, they were happy. And they almost ruined my project. So we always are meeting situation in which reality attacks us when we try to do something, reinvent life and reinvent images and moments.
Pardon. I was just a little sad because my question had been asked in a more general way, but now that I have the microphone, I guess I'm going to ask it a little differently. About the color concept, which was already mentioned and also explained, but what caught my attention was, or what I thought, but I might be overinterpreting, that it has also some influence on the costumes, the costume design, because I had the impression that you played with, like, at first she had like more, the wife Therese had a more reddish dress, and then there was a lot of blue, like also with Emily's work and so on, with the La Poste, the blue uniform and so on, and later on she was red. Was there an idea behind it, or am I making up something?
Il y a un choix, tous les costumes constituent un choix spécifique.
Oui. Even one day, I thought it was, the little girl should be in pink, and we didn't have it. So we took fabric, and on her, I cut the thing, put it on her with two needles, because I wanted the touch. I like the colors to be meaningful in a film. In that case, it was true. It had to fit with the landscape, the colors of the flowers, the tree, etc. And it is true that the second woman, Emily, is vaguely different. And I tell you something about reality. I had shot the film when his widow is alone, and I know that he will come to visit her at her place. And I had made a shot. She had a purple home jacket, I don't know what you call that, robe de chambre. And she was knitting, and he comes and he speaks to her. I'm working on the dubbing on the film, and the guy in the cabin, in the booth, says to me, "Ah, she's pregnant." So what do you mean? Because a woman with needles alone at home is pregnant. And he was right. I ask other people, I say, yes, if she's ethnic, she's pregnant. So we had to redo the shoot, and she read the book. It's interesting because we invent images, but the image sometimes have a strong meaning the way they are read by everybody. So you see, colors are important, and gesture. And so and you notice, then she reads the book when it comes. And they say something which is so true. I still would like to be happy. And why not? When you say she replaced, nobody replaces anybody, but the need of being happy, of not being alone, is natural. The desire is natural. So what we do with all that is very complicated. Then you come to society problem and moral problem and a lot of things.
We have one last question. The reality of the schedule is hitting us. In the
I speak too much. Is that
no, no, no. We will listen forever.
Non, je veux bien revenir justement à ces couleurs qui m'ont ébloui dans les dernières images, ces couleurs d'automne, ces pulls orange, le marron des feuilles et tout ça. Bon, on a l'impression qu'on retrouve là vraiment l'harmonie complète avec la nature, le couple est heureux, est ensemble, porte les mêmes couleurs et tout. Mais en même temps... je me suis rappelée aussi d'un autre trio, pour ainsi dire, comme Jules et Jim et Jeanne Moreau, où il y a aussi une sortie de cette situation qui est la mort. Et dans cette histoire aussi, vous avez capté un instant de bonheur, mais comme vous dites aussi avec les enfants, ça n'aurait pas pu durer. Et donc, est-ce que, bon, sans faire la morale de la situation, mais est-ce que la mort était vraiment la seule sortie de la situation?
Oui, je der Ausgangspunkt ist nochmal die Frage der Farben, die Herbstfarben im Schlussbild, die einen Glückszustand und eine Harmonie suggerieren. Zugleich ruft das aber auch eine Assoziation auf mit einem anderen Film, Truffauts Jules et Jim, einer anderen Dreiecksgeschichte, die aber eben mit dem Tod endet. Hier gibt es ja nun auch ein Todesfall, und die Frage ist, gibt es nur diesen Ausweg oder diese Möglichkeit, diese Dreiecksgeschichte aufzulösen, oder ginge das auch anders?
You know, if you want to make the film deep and meaningful, she had to die, because if she had been alive, what would it be, a story that he goes from one place to another? You know, one of these, I would see like a comedy, which was not the point. So she dies, suicide or not. But it obviously, the film is in summer and the end is in autumn. And you notice the beautiful autumn colors. We prepared the shot. We waited for the 1st of November to shoot it. The film was finished, but then we waited to do that shot. I went myself in a little shop like supermarket to buy the same pullover, because it exists in size woman and size man. And they should be like sometimes when they do a double bicycle and they have the same pullover, you know. And so they should have the same pullover. And I try to make it, I think it goes that they are together, but he's a little alone. It's obvious that we think at least he thinks about his first wife. It's impossible not to see it. But in the same time, they seem very happy. They seem exactly, as you say, in accordance with nature, maybe not exactly happy, but something which is working. Obviously, I should have spoken earlier about Mozart, because the music of Mozart that I chose is perfectly fitting the subject, because there is in Mozart that beautiful idea of happiness, but there is something in it that pinches, that you know it doesn't last. I mean, certainly it's the musician, the composer, for me, that gives us more than anybody else the feeling that it will disappear, that it's dangerous, that it's just a moment. So it is so clear that the big fugue, which is at the end, closes the thing about Mozart, powerful fugue, but with that thing that we know about Mozart, that whatever feels, I feel like this when I listen to his music, it fits the problem that it's beautiful, but it's just a moment. Can we keep it or not? I don't know. But I, comment dire, soigner, I carefully did the end, because it says a lot. Maybe it's okay. The light is beautiful. The children play with the little leaves, and they go together. But nothing is said. You have to make up your own mind about what you feel.
So thank you very much for this very, very interesting talk. Agnes Wader, thank you for being here. And Vincent Sedi.
Merci beaucoup, thank you. Allez. Thank you.